some quantity as a function of G and the energy. By dimensional analysis, so if the dimension of energy is 1, let's say that the dimension of A is P. And let's assume that the dimension of the coupling is nu. So this would be important for the analysis. From the dimension counting, we can figure out that the A should be proportional to the some power of energy. A function of the dimensionless ratio of G divided by energy to the power nu. Okay, so the dimensional analysis tells us that the answer should have this form. So in field theory, oftentimes, so it's very, very difficult to diagonalize a Hamiltonian. There is no way to solve the Schrodinger equation. So most of the times we are left with perturbation theory as the only method. So which means that we can expand this function in power series of G. So this will be some F0 plus F1 G divided by e to the nu. F2 G squared e to the 2 nu and so on. And in principle, we will be able to compute these coefficients by doing perturbation theory. Now the question is, how accurate is the approximation of truncating this series at some point? Yes. We were considering some generic case where we have dimension full coupling. So in principle, it could have had, so in QED, it doesn't have dimension, but in other theories, it may have. And so.
Should Lagrangian have the dimension of energy?
That's right.
And then
Lagrangian density should have, well, Lagrangian, but not Lagrangian.
I mean, the left hand side is Lagrangian, the right hand, they have the Lagrangian fraction, they share the same dimension.
Consider our Lagrangian as L0 plus G, and then some operator that's a function of fields and of their derivatives, which is some polynomial in fields and derivatives. Okay, so depending on what this polynomial is, the coupling may not have any dimension. So generically, it will have some dimension. Okay. Let's try to understand when we can use this expansion. So when it will be accurate. So obviously, corrections are small. If G is much smaller than energy to the power nu. And we see that the crucial point here is the sign of nu. So we should distinguish the cases where nu is positive or negative. So if nu is negative, where nu is so where nu is negative, Then this equation is an equation on the energy, and it requires the energy to be small, right? So in other words, when nu is negative, then corrections are small at small energies. Or which is the same at short distances, large distances. So this means that, okay, in our, well, everyday life, we only deal with very, very low energies compared to those that field theory language can be useful. So this means that such couplings don't really matter in the macroscopic world. So to study them, one needs a particle accelerator or something. So such couplings are called irrelevant. Irrelevant meaning that it's not important at very large distances. So when distances become shorter or energies become larger, the corrections become bigger and bigger, and so they become more and more important. So in the opposite case, corrections are small, and perturbation theory will work at high energies. Or small distances. So this is the opposite situation. It means that perturbation theory will work if you study something localized in space to very, very small distances. But if you want to understand the macroscopic physics, perturbation theory will not be enough. So this means that interactions will change how macroscopic physics look like. So these couplings are called relevant. And so they, this means that interactions affect macroscopic physics. So finally, there is a third case when coupling is dimensionless. So then, well, it's just a number. And there is no energy dependence in this expansion. So it's expansion in the coupling itself. And whether it works or not depends on the numerical value of the coupling. So if it can be the small or big. Well, our ability to do perturbation theory will depend on its numerical value. So this is the case of QED. So in QED, the coupling is a number, a fairly small number, so we can do perturbation theory. So this case is called, it's a marginal case, and the coupling called marginal coupling. Now, the question is, how do we, so it's clear that these three cases, they describe totally different physics, right? So if couplings are irrelevant, then, well, we know that at large distances, fields, particles will behave as free particles. So the interactions will not be important. So in this case, we can say nothing about physics at large distances, because interactions will be extremely strong. And so we need really to solve the problem exactly. Perturbation theory will be of no use. So this is a borderline case. And well, we need to know what is the numerical value of the coupling. So suppose someone gives you a Lagrangian. How to understand what case does it correspond to? Well, let's see how does it work. So as a first example, let me take lambda phi 4 theory. So now I would like to write down the action, which is the integral of the Lagrangian density. And then I know that the action itself is dimensionless. This is because in normal units, the dimension of the action is that of the h bar. And we set h bar to 1. So the action is dimensionless. So the volume element in spacetime has dimension minus 4. And from those two conditions, we deduce that the Lagrangian density should have dimension equal to 4. So let's then look at, so each term should have dimension 4. So let's look at this term. Well, this term contains derivatives. So each derivative has dimension plus 1 because it's inverse. Dimension is inverse to that of the of length. So this term contains two derivatives and two fields. And so its total dimension should be 4. And therefore, phi should have dimension 1. So let's check it on this term. M has dimension 1. So m squared has dimension 2. Phi squared has dimension 2. It all works. So looking at this term, we see that phi to the 4 has dimension 4, and therefore lambda is dimensionless. So lambda is a marginal coupling. And like in QED, the well, the ability to do perturbative expansion will depend on whether this coupling is big or small. So as a second example, we take QED. We already know that E is dimensionless, but let's recover this result from the way of counting that we used for the 5-4 theory. So you see that for the Lagrangian to have dimension 4, F mu nu should have dimension 2. And therefore, A should have dimension 1. Because F mu nu is the derivative of A. Here in this term, let's say, look at, well, this whole combination, the Dirac operator has dimension 1. So from here, we conclude that psi should have dimension 3/2. So 3/2 plus 3/2 gives 3, and then plus 1 gives 4. Then we look at this term. The dimension will be 3/2 plus 3/2 plus 1. Is again 4. And therefore, the coupling constant is dimensionless. So at the fourth example, or third example, let me consider a theory of weak interactions. Which at low energies are described by the Fermi Lagrangian. So in Fermi theory, the Lagrangian is, well, it is built of schematically, it has this form. With some combination of Dirac matrices here and there. For dimensional counting, it doesn't really matter how these currents that interact at the same point look like. So the structure of Lagrangian is of this type. It is characterized by one coupling constant that's called the Fermi coupling, the Fermi constant. So well, let's count the dimensions. So we have four fermion fields, each have dimension 3/2. So in total, the dimension of interaction operator is 6. But the Lagrangian should be dimensionless. So from which we conclude that the Fermi coupling has dimension minus 2. Meaning that weak interactions are irrelevant. And this explains why they're so feeble. So weak interactions are called weak because they lead to very, very tiny effects at low energies. And the reason for that is that the coupling constant that describes them is irrelevant coupling. So since it has dimension minus 2, we can write it as, well, it's proportional to 1 over m squared. Or we can just write it as like that, where this mass is about 100 GeV, 100 times heavier than a proton. And so this parameterization suggests that at energies of order 100 GeVs, the weak interactions will become as strong as, as other types of interaction. Which is actually true, but they also are described by a different theory. So what happens is that, their strength grows, and then they become as strong as electromagnetic interactions. And that energies of order of 100 GeVs, they should be treated in the same footing within the Weinberg-Salam theory, which is a unified theory of electromagnetic and weak interactions. So this is a general fate of irrelevant interactions. So usually, if you have an irrelevant coupling in the Lagrangian, this simply means that this Lagrangian is only valid up to a certain energy scale, so which is determined by the coupling. So the coupling is then equal to 1 over mass to some power. And so the interactions are weak at energies below that mass. And when we reach this mass, this means that most probably the this description just breaks down. Yes?
So it looks like you express the coupling constant in terms of the mass because you needed the coupling constant to have dimension -2 and just the mass. That arrangement to the mass gives you that dimension. But why did you choose the mass instead of a length scale or a time scale or anything else?
Whatever, I could have chosen the length. So, but that's typically, I mean, what can we do with this dimensional analysis? We can estimate, for instance, the probability of beta decay. So we know what parameter center there. There is the proton mass, the electron mass, and this Fermi scale. And so using this, we can estimate immediately how fast will it be. Because it should be proportional to the characteristic energy of decay divided by m squared. Yes? The gravitational coupling is also irrelevant. Right? So it's good that you ask this question. So gravitational coupling. So let's look at the potential. So the Newton's potential is equal to GMM M1, M2 divided by R. So like, so this is like the electromagnetic potential, but with alpha replaced by G times MM. So G times M squared should be dimensionless. So the Newton's coupling also has dimension -2. So gravity is irrelevant. And if you parameterize it by typical mass scale, then it will come in the denominator. So this mass has a name to it. It's called the Planck mass. Or Planck scale. And so in the at Planck scale, gravity becomes as strong as other types of interaction. Below that scale, it's much weaker. So in Planck mass is, it's like 10 to the GeV. So it's extremely high. Yes. Sorry? Yes, it's a long range force. So it's an example of irrelevant interactions that is important at macroscopic scales. But the reasons for that are sort of accidental. So first of all, this is a long range, indeed, the long range force. So there is it leads to power-like forces, unlike, say, nuclear forces that have finite range. And it's universally attractive, so it cannot be screened. There are no anti-gravity. So otherwise, I mean, the electromagnetic interactions are much, much stronger. But since there are more or less equal number of positive and negative charges, then at large distances, the interactions are simply screened. And so gravity simply has no competitors at large distances. That's why it's more important than everything else. Okay, so the last thing I wanted to tell you is that in this dimensional counting, if you have, if your interaction Lagrangian has the form G times some local operator, then G plus the dimension of operator, which we'll call delta, is equal to 4. So the dimension of the coupling is equal to 4 minus delta. So the relevance or irrelevance of this interaction depends on whether the dimension of the operator is bigger than 4 or smaller than 4. So if delta is smaller than 4, then the dimension is positive. So this is relevant interaction. And then the corresponding operator is called relevant operator. If delta is exactly 4, then we have a marginal operator. So for example, phi 4 operator in the scalar theory is marginal. And finally, if it's bigger than 4, then we have irrelevant operator. So now the truth is that there is lots and lots of irrelevant operators, but the number of relevant and marginal operators is typically finite. So the number of relevant is always finite in any given theory and can be zero. I mean, the number of operators. So this is typically finite. There are some few examples where there is an infinite number of marginal operators. So one you will see on the tutorial. But typically, it's also there is a finite number of marginal operators. And so this makes life quite a lot easier. So if you want to understand, so someone gives you a theory but doesn't tell you how interactions look like. Well, in practice, you don't need to really know this, because most of the, if you want to study the physics at large scales, because then you need only to keep relevant and marginal couplings. And there is just a finite number of them. So for instance, you can convince yourself that in QED, the only possible coupling is, I mean, of this type is marginal. And this is just a QED coupling. The reason for that is that if you add more fields, every field has positive dimension. And derivative has a positive dimension. So if you add fields or your derivatives to your interaction Lagrangian, then you raise the dimension of the operator. And this makes it the operator more and more irrelevant. So in the scalar theory, so let's consider scalar theory as an example. So what are relevant and marginal operators? So phi has dimension 1. So the only relevant operator will be phi cube. And the only marginal operator will be phi to the 4. So all other operators will have dimension greater than 4. Now, if we impose the condition that the Lagrangian should be invariant under phi going to minus phi, so then we exclude this coupling, and then the only coupling possible is marginal. If we allow the potential to have a cubic term, then there is also one relevant interaction. And okay, I guess I'm really over time. So if you have questions, maybe you could ask them in the beginning of the next lecture. Thank you.